Welcome, everybody. Those who are back after the break. Is it possible if people can move a little bit forward? It's easier to talk. That I can see you, see your expressions. If you like, you can move forward. Thank you. How is enterprise problem solving different from what you see in courses, what you see online? Well, first of all, let's set some basis. We'll say, we talk about intelligent systems. What is intelligence? It used to be, or human intelligence, people think of as, you know, what is the easiest way or most efficient way to achieve human goals? And the specific thing there is, how do you discriminate between positive and negative approach towards the goal? Are you achieving the goal or not? Now, if the goal is not specified, any path will take you there, as the Cheshire Cat told Alice in Wonderland. The old definition of machine intelligence was, you find the most efficient way to realize machine goals. Let me change that today, with help from Dr. Stuart Russell. Because the old way, the machines would continue operating even if the previously assigned goal would contradict some human goals coming forward. The new machine intelligence should be, we find the most efficient way to help humans realize uncertain human goals, as in they may change, and keep checking if the goal has changed. Now, with that preface, let's look at systems that can amplify humans in the enterprise. We're not trying to replace humans, we're trying to amplify humans. And a lot of you are familiar with this likely. You have RDBMSs, you know, with structured databases, information extraction from text, audio, video. You have sensors with Apache Kafka, Spark, Storm. Now notice that these all operate at what I would call leaf nodes of a model system. Right? So, you know, for example, your deep learning models, your vision, NLP, all of that will be at that level. Right? Now, to integrate together, you need some kind of inference systems, which is what I show here, the dynamic causal models at multiple levels. Okay? And eventually, you want to be able to generate hypotheses, do what-if analysis, make decisions. Right? Now, notice again, amplify humans, not replace humans. So now, generally what we consider machine learning use cases are moonshots by tech giants. Often, you know, think of things like image identification, language translation, or, you know, self-driving cars. Often there is large volume of labeled data. Now, this is a challenge, this could be a challenge. The training time or cost is not a challenge. And the goal is to provide fully automated decision making. Often you might use custom algorithms. Now, this is only a part of what is needed for the enterprise. So enterprise use cases often look very different. What do they look like? Did I break something? Okay, welcome back. One is, in an enterprise, you will have limited training data. Some of it may be labeled, some of it is unlabeled. It's not initially clear if the training data you have will look like what you'll see in the field. You may need to apply many techniques. There may be specific cost, time, performance constraints, resource constraints, and often you need a decision support system, not a replacement for humans. You don't need a fully automated system. So you might say, okay, so this goes back to the title of our talk. I've solved a certain game, chess, go, whatever, right? What is this little enterprise problem for you? If I can play chess, if I can play go, I can solve any problem. Well, in the enterprise, the problem statement is not well formulated. Just like in chess, you need to get to a checkmate. I don't know what to do in the enterprise. I need to define that. Now, this one requires very careful science of the domain, which means you really need to be an expert in the domain. If you're not, we'll see what happens if you're not. The goal needs to be clearly determined and carefully specified. And as we saw, if you don't know where the goal is, any path will take you there. Now, it's very interesting that the models, the questions that the model need to answer are counterfactual, as in those facts you have not seen. You need to be able to ask questions like, what if this did not happen? What if this happened, perhaps, are easy to answer. And in games, especially, two-player or even single-player full information games, the rules of the game, which is relationships of the entities, and the board, which is the causal domain knowledge, that is well known. Whereas in the enterprise, this is not the case. And also, you cannot play against yourself. You know, if the enterprise starts playing against itself, it's a big problem. Then, data is often not predetermined. If you've solved a challenge on Kaggle, you are already given the data. It's pre-collected, it's given to you, and it's cleaned. Now, in the real world, you clean the data. You may call yourself a data scientist, but you end up being first a data janitor. Now, often the data cannot be generated on demand. In games, you can generate it on demand. The data changes in the real world. In a computation, the data is fixed. In the real world, the data keeps coming, both the training and the test set. And you need to model a process. We'll come back to this one. And there's lack of direct feedback. There is no leaderboard. For example, in Kaggle, you can say, how far do I have to go to do well? Now, in the enterprise, nobody tells you that. You are the leader. You need to figure out what is the end point. Operationally, what's different in the enterprises? Well, the models seem to work with people. Now, people are very smart. People can work around what your model does. So this is a fundamental problem in AI, that you create an AI system and people know how to work around it. And also, you need to convert nearly all inputs to vitamin M, as in money. There's behavioral psychology, which we'll see in the example I show you. The interventions and analysis are driven by often irrational choices. So now, how does your, quote, rational model take care of that? We'll talk about that. And there are constraints in terms of solution complexity, response time, and so forth. Engineering and scalability can kill you, as any engineering director or manager will tell you. Also, we're living in a world where integrative AI models are getting better and better at what they do. Now, the challenge here is, who would be to blame if the advice given by my system is found erroneous? Perhaps due to brittleness, we'll also talk about this. Or the advice is right and it gets disregarded. So, who's to be liable for that? And last one, decisions are supposed to be driven by understanding causes of something, right? If a certain action of a customer or a certain action on my part leads to higher sales, then I'm going to do more of that. So you understand some causal relationship. Now, therefore, encoding and using that causal knowledge is critical. Now, what we'll do in this talk is, so I talked about 12 things here that you can do in the enterprise that you need to do. We don't have time today for all of them. We'll only talk about one, which is this causality. And we'll keep drilling down deeper into this. So, and before we get into causality, we'll see what it takes to create such systems at scale. So in the textbooks, in a lot of courses that you take, this is what you see. You have training data, you have a learning algorithm, you get a model, runtime predictions. This is what you see. In the real world, this is what you see. Come to Oracle, this is what you see. Your data has to have legal review, it has to be crowdsourced. You need interpretations, you need explanations. Again, I will not have time to go through this, but very interesting. And this is just for one model. Now notice, I showed in this previous slide about amplifying humans, that it's not just one model, there may be hundreds of models working together. So this is just for one model. Right? And not just that, so that, now take that, all those 200 models, put it into that ML code piece, and now you still have the issues of configuration, data collection, feature extraction, verification, serving infrastructure. There's a lot of work for all of us. And this is, interestingly, assuming all purely data-driven systems. Now, a lot of people say, there was a colleague of mine yesterday who was saying, what's wrong with just throwing all my data at some set of functions and finding some nuggets serendipitously? Now, if you, on a serious note, if you have that kind of money lying around, we can talk. But even for very well-designed systems, what actually happens is, there exist problems. Because models may not capture the underlying data generating process, which is what you're actually trying to capture. Even while you may faithfully mimic the I/O, you're not understanding, your model is not understanding the data generating process. And This data generating process comprises the rules of the game. We talked about the rules of the game like chess or go. Now, the rules of your business enterprise. If your model doesn't capture that, you're stuck, and I'll show you why you're stuck. Therefore, what happens is your model is brittle outside the data boundary conditions, as in whatever data you give it, it works fine within that. As soon as you step out, you're finished. But as I said, data keeps changing, the world keeps changing. If the world keeps changing, your model is going to die sooner or later. And because of this, you're unable to answer causal questions, counterfactuals, and we'll see what those are. So we'll see what are these problems very, very quickly. You may not believe me. There are three kinds of brittleness in these data-driven systems, purely data-driven systems. One is as soon as you step out of distribution. And another is you just introduce enough noise, so the system gets fooled, and the human will not get fooled, but the system gets fooled. And we'll see an example of that. And then you can make a perturbation large enough that no human would consider that classification to be in the class if the machine finds it. So we'll just see quickly the examples of that. So there's the first one, out of distribution. Now, case in the point, Dr. Jeffrey Hinton, famous guy, Turing Award winner, he said in 2017, we should stop training radiologists now. Doesn't work. Not so fast, Dr. Hinton. Problem is, you can train all your models on radiology, but you go to the next hospital, it doesn't work because your model is actually learning that this is a portable X-ray machine, that the X-ray came from a certain department, it came from ICU, therefore it has to be cancer, etc. Right? It's not actually honing on in what is a tumor, for example. Right? So this has been found. Now, you can see here, I'm not doing anything fancy. I'm showing the same picture. Right? The first case, it sees a stop sign. Next, see, it sees a dumbbell. You know, it's kind of a dumbbell shaped, and there's a kind of a tennis racket there. Right? We can go into details into this, but on why and when, another talk. The upshot is AI will not replace the radiologists, but radiologists using AI will be able to replace those who do not. Another example, with very small noise. So here, this is a carcinoma example. You add a little noise, first one was benign, this one is malignant. I'll skip this one, that was on natural language. You can do the same kind of perturbation, very interesting perturbation. Now this one is also very interesting. Now in this one, notice that I'm just introducing something, a noise which a human will basically disregard. But the system thinks it's a speed limit 45 problem. Again, here, something human will disregard, the guy wearing a t-shirt, but the system doesn't actually recognize this gentleman as a human. Okay? And you can make large enough perturbations that humans don't consider it in the sample. So for example, the first one is a penguin, according to the ImageNet classification, right here, ResNet, right? Now, all it is doing is it is honing in on the textures. It doesn't really worry about penguins. The second one thinks it's a starfish. And I'm not making this up, this is from the Nature journal, right? So your model may be going after wrong features or concepts or relationships. So another example, right? So you see, the first one is a person, just switch the lips and the eyes, and it thinks it's light brown color, something, right? And the last one, you just change the picture around, and it's not even a person anymore. So is there a fix to this problem? Now, my friend Judea Pearl, who got the Turing Award for coming up with Bayesian networks in 1984, says this requires a causal model of the environment. And it cannot be done at the level of association, and I'll describe what it means, what I mean by that. And there's another story about this, which is Joshua Bengio's point, which is that we are assuming that the test data comes from the same distribution as the training data. And he says that assumption is too strong. This is Joshua's slide, shamelessly copy. This assumption is violated in practice. He says it's often violated. I would say most of the time it's violated. So instead of that, a better assumption is that the test data was generated under the same causal dynamics, as in the same system, but the input data may be very different. The input data may come from very different distributions. So initial conditions may be very different. So this is a better assumption to make. But what that assumption entails is that you know the causal dynamics. If you don't know the causal dynamics, you're stuck. So the examples we saw are that our models are cheating by relying on superficial regularities. Better is to understand causal relationships. And we'll quickly see this, right? This is a great slide for me. Why? Because look at that second plot here. You see this? Exercise is bad for me. It'll increase my cholesterol. Does anybody dispute that based on that data? No, right? So I shouldn't exercise. Well, but if you understand that there is an age factor here, age is a factor here, you suddenly see exercise is beneficial for everybody. You see that? As you exercise more, cholesterol goes down. As you exercise more, cholesterol goes down. So if you did not know, or if you did not take this causal factor into account, the age, then you might think that cholesterol increases with exercise. Okay? So the key thing here is, what kind of questions can you ask your models? So typical questions are, how effective is a given treatment in preventing a disease? Was it a new change in price that caused our sales to go up? What annual healthcare costs can be attributed to obesity? Can hiring records prove an employer guilty of gender or racial discrimination? I'm about to quit my job. Will I regret it? I'm not, but yeah. Okay, so let me skip this. Okay, now I'm mentioning causation again and again, and you guys must be saying, are you crazy, Vikas? We already gave that up in the 60s. Because, you know, we say all correlation is not causation. But hold on. Fine, all correlation is not causation, but some correlation could be due to causation. So, for example, we do worry about causation in real life. You know, does this drug cause a cure, you know, create a cure for this disease? If yes, then take it. If no, don't take it. Right? Or does smoking cause cancer? And this was a huge debate in the 60s, 70s, 80s. And the, you know, tobacco lobby had their own statisticians, and the government has their own statisticians. We can get into that, but interesting discussion. So some correlations are due to causation. We need to find those and eliminate the wrong ones, which we assumed. So we'll talk about this ladder of causation. The wrong one is probability of Y given X. Now, this is nearly 100% of what you will be taught in every single course all over the world. What will you be taught? Prediction, classification, detection, recognition from images, video, speech, audio, text, tables, time series. So the questions you can ask are, what does a symptom tell me about a disease? Would a customer buying toothpaste also buy floss? What does a survey say about election results? Now, the interesting thing about this is it limits your reasoning about if you take a novel action, what would happen. Right? Your survey data cannot tell you if the government were to take a new action, what would happen. They cannot tell you. So how would seeing X change my belief in Y? That's all it tells you, right? So these are probability of X, Y given X, right? So we did an example of this. So I have to point this way. Yeah, I think I have to point that way for this to work right. Okay, all right. Yeah, this works better. All right, so I'm gonna skip some of these because I need to cover something very interesting here. So this is about gender discrimination in hiring. So these are number of males hired, number of females hired, males not hired, females not hired. Now, you will not be able to come up with a machine learning algorithm to solve this problem. This problem is solved. Go back to your class 8, 9, 10. How many ways are there to choose A males out of A plus C males? How many ways are there to choose B females out of B plus D females? Right? And choose, right? And now if you do that properly, right, you set that up properly, all the cases, you come up with what is called Fisher's exact test. You can calculate this. I'll tell you an interesting anecdote about this, what happens in the enterprise. You might say, you know, it's trivial to do, you know, I can just write a simple, you know, loop and do this. I was asked to do this in SQL, right? And I can bet my bottom dollar, you will not be able to implement this in SQL the way it's stated. So I had to go back to Srinivas Ramanujan's lost diaries, find the approximation for the gamma function, Ramanujan's approximation, and plug that in, n square problem becomes order 1. Right? Now, all this fancy thing, good, right? Problem is, okay, I'm going to skip this. Problem is, I still cannot answer certain questions, right? I cannot answer, for example, the question, why was somebody paid less than another person? Because I didn't take into account appraisals. Why are certain groups hired more than others? I can tell you certain groups were hired more than others, but I can't tell you why. Right? Because I didn't take into account the application process or the interview process where, you know, people hire their own friends and so on, right? And what if I shut down the employee referral process? I didn't account for that. So I can't answer those questions. Well, another one. So now you go to the next level. So we already talked about probability Y given X. Probability of Y given Y, if you do something, meaning you change something. You change something under certain conditions Z, then what is the probability of event Y, given that we intervene, set the value of X to X while observing Y. So, for example, what will happen to sales if we double the price of a product? You might say, oh, that's easy. I'll do learn a linear regression. Wherever that price point is, I'll tell you what the sales is. Sorry, it doesn't work like that. Because your data is from maybe 2 years ago or last year. Today, the reality is different. If you change the price, the conditions are not the same. It's not going to work like that. So unless you understand the mechanics of why the sales are affected by the price, you'll not be able to make it work. So these are called causal models, or what if models. You know, if I take aspirin, will my headache be cured? So let's try to make a decision with available data without counterfactuals. So I'll run out of time. I wanted to show you more examples, more fun, but talk to me. And I'll share this with you. So if there's one thing I leave you with is you need to have causal relationships in your model. And I'll show you how, if you don't account for that, you get stuck. So if reaction to a smallpox vaccine kills 99 children, and smallpox itself kills just 40 in a population of 1 million, should I vaccinate my children? Any opinions? Would you vaccinate your children? You would vaccinate? Even though the reaction kills 99? Sorry? Speak louder. As per data, you will not vaccinate. Okay. 99 out of a million. 40 out of a million. Okay. So let's look at it a little bit closely. Okay. So what happens is, let's say most of the population is vaccinated. 99% of the population is vaccinated. 1% is not vaccinated. Among the vaccinated people, 1% get a reaction. And out of those 1%, only 1% die. So 0.1%. Okay? And of course, those who don't get a vaccination don't get a reaction. Now, those who don't get a vaccination, out of those 2% get smallpox and 20% die. Okay? Now, if you just translate that from 1 million to number, what you see is total deaths are 139 and more children die due to reactions than smallpox. Quite clear, right? So now this tells you that, you know, clearly you shouldn't vaccinate. You know, I agree with you. But now I'll disagree. So what if we set the vaccination rate to zero? Right? Population, the vaccination rate was 99%. Now I'm setting it to zero. So this is the causal part I was mentioning. Okay? Now I set it to zero. Now what happens is, on the no vaccination side, you have 100% of the people. Okay? And everything else remains the same. Right? We just change the input. Right? Our machinery remains the same. We just change the input. Now see what happens, right? You have 4,000 deaths due to smallpox, right? And no reaction, of course. Now notice, so not vaccinating would have cost 3,861 children's lives. Right? So sometimes our intuition might indicate one thing, but if you actually go through it, you find out that there are, you have to look at this carefully. So yeah, that's just showing the same thing graphically. Now, how do you integrate these signals from multiple sources? So here's a problem statement, and I'll complete with this. So we had an investment bank. They had 2,000 large clients, each of them with $100 million in investment or more. Some of them had a billion. And each of those had 10,000 to 100,000 users. It cost them $20 million to replace a client. Now, the charge we were given was estimate when these clients might leave. It does not help if you tell me today that the client is going to leave tomorrow. That's useless. If you tell me 9 months ahead of time, I can use that information to, you know, retain them. So the challenge was, when we started off, we were told that customer survey data was golden. We were also told that the KPIs were golden, you know, they indicated something. So we started off, and for 6 months, we were floundering around until we hit upon something interesting in their data. What we found was that about 9 months before the customers would leave, they had very large number of complaints and, you know, phone calls and emails and all that. Then what would happen is about 3 months after that, everything would look beautiful. Very few complaints, very, you know, hardly any bad emails, anything like that. Now, the VP on those accounts would get their bonuses, right? As they should, right? Because everything is fixed. But not quite, because the customer would still leave. Now, the key insight there was that it is a good thing if your spouse is complaining. If your spouse stops complaining, that's when you should be worried. Also true for employees. As long as the employees are saying, you know, we should do this better, we should, you know, improve things, that's a good thing. When the employees stop saying things, you should be worried. So the first thing we did in this system was, we said we have to have close to 100% recall on negative signal. Why? Because you remember, these are $100 million investments, right? So the guy who is responsible for this, they are not going to send you nasty messages that you can catch with, you know, sentiment analysis. Right? They're not going to, you know, shout at you on the phone. Right? They are smoother than that. So remember, this is a further problem. Not only is your spouse complaining smoothly, so you have to catch it, right? But after a while, they stop complaining. So as soon as there is a complaint, you have to catch it. Very important, right? Because if you say, let me average over the, you know, 3 month period, that signal is lost, right? Because the period when they decided they were going to leave. So that's one part. The other part is, we determined that, okay, we did not invest any money into fixing their problems, right? How come there are no complaints after 3 months? Suddenly there are no complaints. So that is the introspection that we had to do in our KPIs. So now, here is this type of problem statement. The probability of customer leaving or staying, given that we intervene and set the value of X is fixed service issues while observing competitor offering better products and no complaints, etc. Right? So we got all of their data, emails, phone records, recordings, everything. Right? And I already described this to you, so I'm going to skip this. Now, the key thing here is, we still could not answer a certain other level of questions, which is, if we had fixed only 50%, no, enterprises are not always, you know, meant for the good of the world. So if we had fixed only 50% of the problems, costing perhaps 70% of the money, would they still be retained? Meaning, should we fix all the problems, or should we just fix few of the problems? Was it enough? Or if we fixed 80% of the easiest problems? Well, we can't answer that question. We don't have that. Right? Our model didn't have that, right? Or if we provided better returns and our website still sucked, would it still work? I can't say that from that model. Again, I wish I could go into the details of the model, but we can discuss offline. Now, how can we create models to answer such questions? I wish I could go into that model, fairly detailed model. I would have to go into the math. So I'll just show you that this top level rung, which is the imagining rung. What if I had acted differently? What if I had eaten less and done more exercise? Was it aspirin that stopped my headache? What would Gandhi have done if somebody had not killed him on this day, so 72 years ago? Right? I can't ask those questions from the previous type of models. Right? So I have to create these new kind of models. For example, the probability that Joe's salary would be Y had he finished college which is X, given that his actual salary is Y prime, and he had only 2 years of college, X prime. So now, these are the kind of questions your very first level of models, which are, you know, those standard machine learning models, cannot answer. Now, for that, you need these causal models. And I am just simply going to skip through this. I should tell you, I have a PhD in biology. So those of you who are trying to get into this field, take heart. This is a network, notice, right? This is a causal network, which is saying one thing affects the other, affects the other, affects the other, negatively, positively, etc. You can write those differential equations, solve those out, and figure out how they affect each other, right? Now, we applied this to a semiconductor company. I'm out of time, but I'll say this last one, where we were able to figure out for a very large problem, it was a $2 billion problem, we could actually figure out these connections and be able to tell you that this product will fail in the next 1 year instead of next 5 years. Anecdotal story, I left a certain company, moved to India, bought a machine with that same processor, died in 1 year. Very good model. It works. You can predict it. And they actually put in a significant amount of money to fix that. So that indicates that when you make those kinds of models, they are deployed in the industry. They can be very powerful, and people make decisions based on that. So need for dynamic causal models in the enterprise. Bell has rung. Thank you very much for your attention. Probably no time for questions, but maybe we'll take one. Just one. Sir.
Follow natural sciences. What if the system does not follow natural sciences? Example, say stock market. It does not follow any law of science or biology or history or whatever. Name a law and it doesn't follow any one of them. How do you define causal models in them when the systems do not follow any of these, like chemistry, biology, do follow some laws of science?
So, two-part answer to that question. One part is, let us first address the problems which have the maximum return. So stock market and problems like that, people have tried to address for many, many years, including, you know, smart folks like D.E. Shaw from Harvard, and spectacularly failed. So that particular example actually is also better addressed through these approaches, because you can say, okay, what are the organic drivers of the stock market? But you will still be wrong. You'll still be wrong, right? So these work best in what are called controlled processes. These kind of models work best in controlled processes. In fact, I would make the claim that any model you create for uncontrolled systems is going to fail. Because, you know, I don't know if you have a background in physics, because of what's called deterministic chaos. So you got my point, that in controlled systems. That's why enterprise, yeah. The external environment is uncontrolled. Internal environment is supposed to be controlled. So that may be true, and your models may actually bring out. So here is how we approach it, right? So you're right about that. You're right. So the way we approach that is, when we create the model, right? We say, okay, this is our best hypothesis today, right? Now, if the data shows me the opposite, right? Then I can go back to my SVP and say, you know what? You are saying your company works this way, but I am seeing completely the opposite, right? So then they can go fix it, right? Which is also what we saw in the biological example, that we say, okay, here is my best hypothesis. Now, if the data breaks my hypothesis, I'm willing to change it. And that's how science advances, right? So in some sense, the argument is for advancement of science of each domain, whether it's HCM or CRM and so on. We are trying to advance the science of each domain. Now, granted, it is a lot harder to do when you're trying to predict what people will do, especially when they're making complex decisions. If they're somewhat easier things like, you know, buying things on Amazon, that's a little easier problem. That's an easier problem, and it's, you know, probability of Y given X kind of problem, right? But the enterprise problem is harder than that, and I agree with you. Yes. Thank you. But if there are other questions, we can take later on. Thanks for your attention.